Okay, so in this session and maybe in the next one, yeah, so maybe in the next 3 hours or whatever, I like to discuss with you the calculation of partial derivatives. In mathematical finance, it's often called sensitivities because the word derivative is used for financial product. So the sensitivities of evaluation, given that the evaluation is performed with a Monte Carlo algorithm, so the partial derivatives of Monte Carlo valuations. And so this is the program for the next session. So I start with an introduction, and what you see here below in Cray are several methods which are not related to mathematical finance. I mean, they are general numerical methods. And the important part is maybe the last or the second last point here on the slide, the numerical experiments. I like to do a code session with you, and we will write some, say, 150 lines. Yeah, so it's a little bit bigger code, but not so big. Yeah, so we can write it live and exploring a lot of aspects with these methods. Well, the mathematical part of many of such methods is often simple. It's even simpler if you look at the method when it is implemented in the computer, because the computer is a discretized machine. Yeah? So often you have to look at these methods then in a discretized setup where the method is even simpler. The devil is in the details, and often the devil is in the implementation part of this. Of these methods. So just as an introduction, yeah. So a motivation to look at partial derivatives is, for example, here that we can express the replication portfolio by looking at partial derivatives of the evaluation with respect to some model parameters. And if the model is calibrated to the market, these model parameters somehow represent the current market prices. So that's the motivation why we look at partial derivatives. The motivation that we use Monte Carlo simulation is that many financial products, like, for example, complex financial products here, Bermudan options, they do not have an analytic formula. So an analytic formula is usually not available. So we have to use a Monte Carlo simulation or some other numerical method. And the Monte Carlo simulation is maybe the method of choice if we are in a high dimensional setup. Yeah? So if the model is high dimensional. Okay, so now we have the two motivations. We like to look at partial derivatives of Monte Carlo valuations. So that is the expectation operator associated with the valuation, which we get from the universal pricing theorem. So we get from this theorem that we can, under certain assumption, express the value of a financial derivative as an expectation of some random variable, which is generated, for example, by a stochastic process, which we call the model. Okay, and how do we arrive at this random variable here, V of t divided by n of t? So we derive there by stating a model. In our case, we looked here at numerical methods to create, say, simulations of heterostochastic processes. So our model looks like this. And that's not what we have in the computer. What we have in the computer is a discretization of this model. So a next step that generates the random variable V of t divided by N of t is to create an approximation using a time discretization scheme. So we get some x of ti. So let's call it X star of TI, since it could be an approximation, not clear that we get the exact solution. So for example, you can take here an Euler scheme, which is this rule here on the right-hand side. So we have all implemented this, so we can now generate this Euler discretization. And then I assume that my financial derivative, which is the value, is the expectation of this future value or of this cash flows, of the future cash flows or whatever, can be expressed as a function of realizations of this time discrete stochastic process X. So I assume that here my V of T is a function of these guys. So this means that actually I just like to calculate the expectation of F of Y, where Y is just a vector, maybe very high dimensional, of random variables generated from my numerical scheme. So that's our setup. Yeah? We have numerical methods to create this F of Y. Yeah? F is maybe the payoff function, and the X vector is the model of the underlyings, for example, the stock and the bank account and so on. Okay, so actually here in this setup, we have two approximation steps involved. Yeah. The first approximation step is that with the numerical scheme. Okay, so this one is the approximation step coming from our numerical scheme, which replaces Y by Y star, and Y X star is the, say, for example, Euler approximated values. And the second approximation step in the valuation is that we express the expectation operator here by some E hat. Okay, so the E hat is our Monte Carlo approximation of the expectation operator. Okay, in this setup, I do not consider so much the first approximation step. Let's assume that the Euler scheme is given, or maybe set X star is our stochastic process. And it's more the second approximation step that is causing the problems here. So what's the issue if we calculate now a partial derivative? Of our expectation of Y with respect to some parameter. So let's consider a general setup where our parameter is, say, some general model parameter, could be the initial value of the stochastic process, could be the volatility, could also be something else, something that is inside this F of Y theta. So let's assume that theta is some model parameter, and we would like to differentiate this expectation of F of Y theta with respect to this parameter. So this means that I now consider Y as a function of theta, and we differentiate with respect to this theta. In the case that I have a density for this random variable Y, I can express the expectation as the integral over F of Y times the density. So if I have a density, I can express the expectation as a convolution here with the density. Okay. And you see that this means that assuming I can interchange integration and differentiation. So let's assume that we can interchange here the integration and differentiation. So then I differentiate here f of y times the density. Okay, and now assume that the model parameter is only inside the how we generate the y. Okay, so this means that I just differentiate the density. Okay, f of y times differentiate the density of this random variable, which depends on my parameter with respect to theta. Okay, so think, for example, that we have a Bachelier model, then this is the density of the normal distribution, e to the minus x square, half. This is a very smooth function, C infinity. So differentiating this density is C infinity again, and everything is smooth. Yeah? Also here, if you look at the left-hand side, the Bachelier formula differentiated with respect to the initial value or whatever parameter is a very smooth function. So the result here is smooth. Say smooth if phi is smooth. Yeah, C infinity, for example. Even if f is non-smooth. Yeah? So actually, the differentiability of the function f is not so important here for us. Yeah? So this guy here could be discontinuous. Okay. So but now, how does this look if we not differentiate the expectation, if we differentiate the Monte Carlo approximation? Actually, what we do is we have an approximation and we differentiate the approximation. Differentiation of an approximation is often a bad idea. It's better to approximate the differentiation instead of differentiating the approximation. So what happens if we now differentiate the Monte Carlo integral? So the Monte Carlo integral is here. So we replace expectation operator by this e hat. So the e hat is my finite sum over f evaluated at a finite number of sample paths, y theta of omega I. And if I now differentiate this guy, so let's do this here, d by d theta of this e hat f of y theta. Okay, I always write it as conditional expectation, but that's not so relevant in this section here. So then I can interchange the finite sum and the differentiation. So what I get is I differentiate here below the sum. So I differentiate f of y theta at omega I. Okay, and now you see that I actually need here differentiability of the function f. Okay, it was not relevant in the analytic representation of the expectation, but now if I like to continue here, I need that I can differentiate f. Yeah? So I have here f prime, differentiate f with respect to its arguments. So if y is a vector, yeah, and then times differentiate this y with respect to theta. Okay, so you see that we here need a little bit of regularity from the function f, which we did not need in the analytic case. Okay, so that was a small introduction. And actually, the methods which we had here on the list, they differ in how they treat smooth and discontinuous payouts. So actually, they differ exactly with respect to this question. Do we have a smooth function f? Can I differentiate here? Or don't we have a smooth function there? And because this is a very nice thing to study these methods, I would like to discuss the two examples, the linear and the discontinuous payouts. Okay, so let's start with a linear payout. So we consider the case that actually y is only x of capital T. So that is, I also in financial mathematics speech, I would say that this is a European option style or European style product. Yeah, so a European product, so that means that y is just a single realization at a few fixed future point in time, capital T. And then I assume that my payoff is a linear one. Yeah? So I assume that the function f is just ax plus b. Okay, so, and of course, we assume that our y depends on some parameter theta, some model parameter which determines the values of the x of capital T. So for this one, let's have a look at the analytic solution. What happens if we apply the differential operator to the expectation? Okay, so if we move the expectation, yeah, if we are able to move the expectation under the integral, this means that I can differentiate the function f. Okay, so going back here to this slide, I can here calculate this f prime is just a, yeah, f prime is just a. So in this case, I have a times the expectation of dy by d theta. Okay, so if y is generated by a nice model, Black-Scholes, Bachelier, anything which has a nice density here, I assume that dy by d theta is also some random variable, which behaves quite nice. And we can maybe approximate this random variable by a Monte Carlo approximation. So what happens if we now perform a Monte Carlo approximation and differentiate the Monte Carlo approximation for the linear payoff? Okay, so I differentiate the Monte Carlo operator. So we have here the Monte Carlo operator. Yeah, so that is, I have there my Monte Carlo sum. I can interchange differentiation and summation. And again, differentiating f is just a. So what I get is a times the Monte Carlo approximation of dy by d theta. So you see, in this case of the linear payoff, everything behaves quite natural. The differentiation of the Monte Carlo approximation gives us the approximation of the differentiation. So looks quite nice. Now let's take a look at the discontinuous payoff. So I'm looking now also at say some European style function. So this here is European option. Okay, it's European option because here we have of X of capital T. So I only decide what I pay at a fixed point in the future, a fixed point in time in the future. And it's a digital option because my payoff is here the indicator function. Okay, if X of T is larger than K, I pay you 1, otherwise I pay you 0. Okay, so what's happening if we now differentiate the expectation of this F of X of T, and if we differentiate the Monte Carlo approximation of the expectation of this F of X. So let's first again look at the analytic solution. Well, to derive it just on a single slide, let's just make a small approximation here. Y at theta plus h is y theta plus dy by d theta times h plus order h squared. Yeah, so I have a Taylor expansion in the parameter theta here. So I assume that my random variable depends smoothly on this parameter. Yeah. So the only non-smooth part here in this game is the function f. Yeah. So this guy, he has the discontinuity. Y is depending smoothly on this parameter theta. So the expectation of f of y theta plus h. So if f is an indicator function, then expectation of this indicator function is just the probability of the set where the indicator function is 1. And what is the set where this indicator function is 1? So this is just the set where y theta plus h is bigger than k. Yeah? And y theta plus h bigger than k, if I now use my small Taylor expansion here, means that y theta is larger than k minus dy by d theta times h, and then minus a term which is order h squared. Okay, so that means that this expectation is just the probability that y theta is larger than k minus dy by d theta times h minus order h squared. Yeah? And from that, the probability. Yeah? Okay, so if I have a density, yeah, so let's assume that we have a density, so the guy is very smooth here. So that means that I have an integral from k minus dy theta d theta times h minus the term order h squared to infinity over the density. So now I take a finite difference and take the limit h to 0, yeah, to approximate my differential. So what I do here is we take d by d theta of the expectation as the limit of expectation of f of y theta plus h minus expectation of f of y theta minus h. So this means that I have the two integrals which we subtract. So if we plot maybe here the density, so let's plot here the density. So this is our density. Then there is some value, say k. So this here is the value k. So this means that here this point, this is phi of k. So the density at phi of k. So then I have an integral from k minus dy by d theta times minus h up to k minus dy by d theta plus h. Yeah. So there is here some, interval. Okay. The size of this interval here, the size of this interval is dy by d theta times 2h. Yeah. So coming from here. Now I have the interval with the bound with minus h and plus h. Okay. So the area which we have here is the width times the height. Yeah, so what is the size? This is dy by d theta multiplied with phi of k and the 1 divided by 2h cancels this guy here. So we see the analytic solution of differentiating this expectation of the discontinuous function is just the density at k, the point where we jump, times the velocity of the boundary. So this here is the density where we jump. So this is the density at the jump. And this here is the velocity with respect to theta of the location where the jump is. Yeah. So this here is the, let's write it here, velocity of the jump as a function of theta. Okay, so maybe we have now a quite good understanding what is happening here if we have the discontinuous payoff. What happens if we look at the Monte Carlo approximation? So for the Monte Carlo approximation, we are differentiating the Monte Carlo sum, which means that we are differentiating here this function f of y theta. So let's plot f of y theta here. F is a discontinuous function, so it looks like this. It is zero here, so this here is the k. Yeah, so I plot it as a function of the y. So it is zero here, it is one here. And now I perform Monte Carlo samplings. So I have this Monte Carlo value, this Monte Carlo value. Yeah. Okay, and now if you differentiate with respect to some parameter and the red dots move a little bit, yeah, they do not change at all. Yeah, the value of f of y doesn't change at all. So at every such red point, the differentiation is zero. Yeah? So either I'm on the side where it's zero or I'm on the side where it's one and I make an infinitesimal change. And assuming that I'm not exactly at k, this infinitesimal change will never cross k. Yeah? So the differential is zero. This is what we will also see in the Monte Carlo simulation later in our computer experiment. Okay, so you see that the Monte Carlo approximation differentiated gives us a result which is always wrong. Okay, so I have here the small assumption that I do not hit the K, yeah, where you know the differential would be a Dirac delta. Okay, so where this is not differentiable, but for the Monte Carlo, this is okay. Yeah, so we draw a set of random numbers and well, maybe we don't hit K. So that was the setup of the two examples, the smooth payoff, in my case, the linear one, and the discontinuous payoff, in my case, just the digital option, which we will often use to illustrate one of the following methods. And let's start by looking at what happens if we do finite differences. Okay, so we take a look at the finite difference approximation. So the finite difference approximation is here this first step. I approximate the derivative operator d by d theta with a finite difference on the parameter with a fixed shift size h. So you know that in the computer, we have to be careful how we choose h. Yeah. So let's assume we have chosen h fixed. So then this here is our finite difference. We take the expectation at the model parameter theta plus h, and we take the expectation of our evaluation using the model parameter theta minus h. We take the difference of the two and divide by h. So then the next step is to consider the Monte Carlo approximation. And here you already see that now if I approximate the expectation operator with the Monte Carlo approximations, then I get the finite difference of the Monte Carlo approximation. So actually the two approximations, they commute. Yeah. So taking the finite difference and then applying the Monte Carlo to each expectation operator is actually the same as taking on the original expectation operator the Monte Carlo approximation, and then of the two of this one, the finite difference. Okay, and the result is that we apply finite difference to the Monte Carlo sum. So that's the result here. So what we do here is we apply the pathwise finite difference. Yeah? So this here is the Monte Carlo approximation. Yeah, the Monte Carlo approximation, because here you see this is just a Monte Carlo integral of the pathwise, because you see I have here always the same path, yeah? The pathwise finite difference. So I'm applying on every Monte Carlo path the finite difference operator. This is a very nice method, and actually maybe it's also my favorite method. If you do the implementation right, yeah, you can get very far with this method. You can even implement the likelihood ratio method as a disguised finite difference method. We will have a look at this in a later session. What is so nice about this method? The only thing we need to do is perform two evaluations. You see, if you take a look here, this is a Monte Carlo approximation of the finite difference. But you can also do it like this. You take the Monte Carlo approximation of evaluation at f of y at theta plus h, and the Monte Carlo approximation of f at y theta minus h. So the only thing you need is to create your model with different parameters. So you need very few information about the whole model. It is a black box. You have a black box, you can shift the parameter, then you can calculate this finite difference approximation. So for all the methods, I will summarize some of these requirements. And for this method here, we have that we need no additional information on the stochastic process. I do not need to know the density, for example. I also need no additional information on how X was simulated. I don't need to know if it was an Euler scheme or Milstein scheme. I have no need to know anything about the function f. Yeah. So for example, we do not need to differentiate f. I don't need to know this. And I also need to know nothing about theta, except that I can change theta. So when here there is written no additional information, it means nothing additional to what we need to perform evaluation. So this means once we are able to evaluate expectation f y theta for different theta, then we can apply this method. Yeah. So no additional means no additional information once we are able to perform the evaluation. There are some things on the downside. If you take the shift size too large, you get a biased derivative. This is just because finite difference is just an approximation, and yeah, you have a Taylor expansion remainder term maybe kicking in. If you take the shift size too small, we get problems. I will illustrate these problems. And before I illustrate it, let's continue a little bit on these properties and these remarks. But I will illustrate the second point, the problem, of course, using our linear and discontinuous payoff. So here are a few remarks. So the most important feature of this method is that it is so generic. So just consider that you are working in a team, and once your team has developed the valuation algorithm, you are immediately able to calculate finite differences. But you have to be careful, there are issues. So for smooth payoff, there are maybe no issues. Okay. But for discontinuous payoffs, they are issues. And the reason that a discontinuous payoff is a problem is exactly what we have seen on the previous slide, that if we differentiate the Monte Carlo sum analytically, yeah, then we get for a discontinuous function for digital option zero on every pass. So actually the two approximations, finite difference approximation and Monte Carlo approximation, they do not commute if the parameter h is taking to zero. So for discontinuous payoff, we would probably expect that we have a problem if h is very small, yeah? Because we have no convergence if h goes to zero. I would expect that there is something dangerous happening there. Let's just check what is happening by looking again at our linear and discontinuous payoff now with finite differences. So for the linear payoff, so my linear payoff, let's just copy it here. It was f of y is just f, I take an European style product, so just at this x of t, and this is a x of t plus b. No? So then our first step is to perform the finite difference approximation. Our second step is to perform the Monte Carlo approximation. Okay, so this here is our Monte Carlo approximation of the finite difference. And if we apply this to the function ax of t plus b, yeah, in the finite difference, the b vanishes. And I can move the a in front of the finite difference. And I just have that this is 1 divided by 2h, the finite difference of my underlying y. Yeah? So just the finite difference of the underlying y. So that corresponds to, let's check, where was this slide? That corresponds here to this case where we are just differentiating here, where A just moves in front of the expectation operator. So, by the way, I would like to make a small remark here. Is this term here, if you differentiate the linear payoff, the expectation of the linear payoff, is this term here maybe an issue? And let's have an example here. And as an example, take the Black-Scholes model. So let's take ds is rs dt plus sigma s dw. So s of 0 is s 0. And let's assume that my x of t is just the s of t and my theta is just the initial value. So I would like to differentiate with respect to the initial value. So what's this term here? So this term is ds of t by ds of 0. Okay, so what's s of t in the Black-Scholes model? Let's write this first. So in the Black-Scholes model, s of t, I know the analytic solution, is s0 times exponential rt minus 1/2 sigma squared t plus sigma w of t. Yeah? Okay, so if you now differentiate ds of t with respect to ds 0, that's just this guy here is differentiated. So this is just the exponential of all this stuff. So this is just s of t divided by s of 0. Okay, so you see this random variable here inside is, you know, a very friendly guy. Yeah, it's, and we are just taking the expectation of s of t. Yeah? So there's nothing special happening. So the Monte Carlo error of this approximation here, yeah, is just the Monte Carlo error we would expect in a usual valuation. Okay, so we were discussing the finite difference. So let's go back to the slide with the finite difference. It's here. And let's take a look at the same example. Yeah? So example again here, Black-Scholes model. ds is rs dt plus sigma s dw. So theta should be just the initial value. X is just the stock. Okay, so what's the finite difference of S of capital T with respect to a shift in S zero. Yeah? So that's just 1 divided by 2H. And then we have S zero plus H times the exponential, yeah, and so on, you know, minus S zero minus H times the exponential. Okay. And you see S zero minus S zero goes away. Plus H minus minus H is 2H divided by 2H. This is just the exponential of the drift plus the diffusion. So this is just S of capital T divided by S zero. And this is the analytic solution. So you see that in this case, that we have a Black-Scholes model, the x of t is just the s of t, and we are differentiated with respect to the initial value. The finite difference is exact. Yeah? So there's no additional approximation error coming from performing a finite difference. The only approximation error is coming here from our Monte Carlo approximation step. So that guy here. That's the only approximation error. The Monte Carlo is the other one. Make this guy. Yeah, so here. So there's no approximation step coming from the finite difference. The only approximation error is coming from our Monte Carlo approximation for the linear payoff. So if I have a linear payoff, finite difference is a perfect method. And you also see that here, this is independent of H. Yeah? It's independent of H. So you can use a large shift size. Linear payoff, smooth payoff, you can use a large shift size. Let's have a look now at the discontinuous payoff. So for the discontinuous payoff, I pay you 1 if I'm larger than k, otherwise I pay you 0. Let's first apply the finite difference. First we apply the finite difference. Then we apply the Monte Carlo approximation. Okay, so here we have now the Monte Carlo approximation of the pathwise finite difference. Okay, and now I'm applying a finite difference to a discontinuous function. So I'm applying it to the function which is 0 here. Then at k, the function moves to 1 and it stays 1. Okay, and then you apply on every Monte Carlo path, omega I, this finite difference. So assume that, let's say, this here are the Monte Carlo sample points. Say, let's call them omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, we sample. If we use the parameter theta plus h, and then for the parameter theta minus h, so this parameter, we get slightly shifted values. Okay, then the finite difference of these values is always 0. Yeah? So this here is for, let's say, in my picture, for omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. Unless it happens that our queen point is very close to k, on the left-hand side, such that if we take the parameter theta plus h, the other point is on the other side of k, so it jumps to this point, in which case we get here a very large difference, namely, in this case, yeah, if this is theta plus h, it is 1. So this here is the case. We get 1. So let's call this point here, say, omega 4. So maybe this is omega 4. If we get 1, depends if we move to the left or to the right, if we increase or decrease the parameter theta. So actually, this depends on the derivative dy by d theta. Yeah? Do your points move from the left to the right if you increase your parameter, or do your points move from the right to the left if you increase your parameter? Okay, and then we divide this by 1 by 2h. So we have a factor of 1 divided by 2h. For small h, this is a very large number. So from this picture, you see the following. Very often, we get 0. And rarely means if we are close to k, we get a large number. So rarely we get something large. Okay, and when do we get something large? So if I assume that h is small, so that 1 divided by 2h is large. So we get it when we are close to k. So let's investigate this a little bit more in detail. I simplify this a little bit. Actually, it's not a big simplification. I could also use it with a Taylor expansion. But to ease maybe notation, let's consider that y theta plus h is just y theta plus dy by d theta times h. So it's a linear function in theta. So just assume this for simplicity, because then I can write this finite difference a little bit nicer. So whether you are in the case that you get plus 1 or minus 1, can now be written just by the sign of the derivative dy by d theta. Yeah? Do you move to the right or do you move to the left if theta moves? So this simplifies a little bit here how I can write this formula. And I can also express now when do we get this 1. Or minus 1, it is if y of theta is within some epsilon interval around k. So here's k. So now I have some epsilon interval here. And this here is, say, some 2 epsilon. Epsilon to the left, epsilon to the right, yeah, so a 2 epsilon interval to be precise. Okay, and epsilon is how much do we shift theta? So how much do we shift theta? So we shift it by h. And how does y change when theta changes? So it changes by dy by d theta. So the epsilon is just dy by d theta times h. Okay, and since epsilon should be positive, h is positive, I take here the absolute value of the derivative. So, and now I can calculate what does this rarely on this slide mean. So what's the probability to get this jump, yeah, to lie in this interval? Okay, so the probability to lie in this interval is the probability that y of theta lies in this 2 epsilon interval around k. So this is like I have illustrated before on the slide. Yeah. So like we have seen on this slide here. So this is here this interval. Yeah, and there's the probability density. So this is just the probability density of y theta at k multiplied with the size of this interval. This is the probability that we lie in this interval. Huh? So how likely is it that y is in this region and how large is the region? So I'm plugging in the definition of my epsilon. We get that this is the density times the speed of y as a function of theta times my shift size, 2h. So now if you take the finite difference, you divide here by 2h, and you see, you get actually the analytic solution. The analytic solution is the density times the speed of the boundary. Okay, so this looks very nice. Yeah? So we have very rarely this value here, 1 divided by 2h. So how often do we have it? So what is the expectation? The expectation is the probability times this value. And you see here the sign will make this absolute value here go away. So in expectation, so if we take the expectation of this, this is the pathwise finite difference. If we take the expectation over all paths, we get the true solution. Looks very nice. We can apply finite difference to a discontinuous function. And if we take the expectation, we get the true solution. There is a small approximation step here. And this approximation step is that one, which is due to the case that our density is just evaluated at k, but actually I would need the integral over this interval. Yeah? So if I take h smaller, yeah, this should become more accurate. Okay, so actually you see that the finite difference of the discontinuous function doesn't look so bad, because this here is what we would expect from our first from our first look here at the analytic derivative of the discontinuous function. I would expect this part here. Okay. The issue is that what we do here is a Bernoulli experiment. I get either this value or zero, and this is the probability that we get this value. So this is a Bernoulli experiment. Okay. And the expectation of the Bernoulli experiment gives us the analytic solution approximately. Yeah. So this approximation here is because we have a finite shift size. So this is the expectation. So, but what is the variance of the Bernoulli experiment? So the variance of this experiment here is the value squared times q times 1 minus q. The value squared is 1 divided by 2h squared times q times 1 minus q. So this is a term which is of the order 1 divided by 2h. Yeah. So you see that the probability to be in this interval here, this is a term which has a 2h inside. Yeah? Phi of k dy by by d theta times 2h. This is the q. But then I have a 1 divided by 2h squared. So the variance explodes if h becomes too small. So now we have the problem that for the linear payoff, we had the result that the Monte Carlo error of the finite difference is just the same as the Monte Carlo error of the valuation. And here we have the problem that the Monte Carlo error of the finite difference explodes if we take h too small. Okay, so the discontinuity makes the Monte Carlo error becoming worse. So before I go to the next session, I like to do a small computer experiment and actually show you what is happening here. And then we will learn other methods, which are actually somehow dual. They do not have the problem with the discontinuous functions, but they have problems with the continuous functions, with the smooth functions. So before we do this, let's try and implement a little bit of stuff. So how much time do we have? 25 minutes. So maybe we will have to continue this programming session in the next session because it will be a larger program, but I would like to build everything from scratch so that you see that everything is really nicely done, and we can do we can also inspect the other method, which this program. Okay, so let's create here a small program to investigate a little bit the finite difference approximation, and I would like to do it in a Black-Scholes model. Not finite difference, let's call it sensitivities. Let's call it Monte Carlo Black-Scholes sensitivities experiments, yeah, or maybe we can call it Black-Scholes delta because I will only look at the delta experiments. So I would like to look at the Black-Scholes model, calculating the derivative with respect to the initial value, the delta. I like to use different methods to do this. So let's start and define my model parameters. So I would like to have a Black-Scholes model with some initial value. Say this is 100. We will take some Monte Carlo simulation. So I need a Monte Carlo seed. Let's take some number for Monte Carlo seed. And I need a lot of other parameters, but now I like to put the other parameters inside here. Why do I like to put the other parameters not as a global class wide constant? Because by putting the parameters here, I have to pass the parameters to the functions which we will write, and by that we will actually see what is needed for the different methods. This is also sometimes quite nice. If you perform implementation, then by understanding the implementation, which function needs which parameter, you also have maybe a clearer understanding of the mathematical properties. Okay, so I have a Black-Scholes model with some risk-free rate and volatility. I look at a European option, which with some maturity and some strike, and I take a Monte Carlo simulation of an Euler scheme. So the Euler scheme just needs one time step. One time step is okay because I do not have any intermediate values. So let's take dt equals 5, so then also the program runs faster. And I take a Monte Carlo simulation with 10,000 passes. So Before we investigate now what happens to the finite difference approximation, I need to create such a Monte Carlo method. And so let's pass here the parameters we need to create the Monte Carlo approximation. So what we need are the model parameters, we need the time discretization parameters for the numerical scheme, and we need the number of passes. Okay, and we actually need the seed. Actually, this initial value, I could spare it. I don't need to pass it as a parameter. But I don't care. So let's create a function that creates us a model. And maybe meanwhile, maybe I remove this because it's not needed. So these are my model parameters here. Yeah. So meanwhile, you know that we have developed some code to create such models. Yeah. So we have everything at hand. So we have a Black-Scholes model. So we have a Java class that specifies for us the drift, the numerea, and all the stuff. Black-Scholes model. So Black-Scholes model, what does it need? It needs the initial value. It needs the risk-free rate and the volatility. So everything is already filled in here. So then, you know, I have also a Java class which creates a Brownian motion. Let's call it BM. So I create a Brownian motion using maybe Mersenne-Twister random number generator. So for that, I need a time discretization. So let's have a time discretization. I need a time discretization with some initial value, which is zero, number of time steps, which is the integer round. It is the time horizon divided by the delta t. And the time step size of my time discretization should be dt. So how many factors does the Brownian motion have? It's one. How many passes is number of passes? And the seed is just my seed. So I hope this is correct. Let's see. Number of paths, seed, factors, time discretization. Yes. So now we have a problem in motion. Then I can create an Euler scheme. So let's create the stochastic process. So this is an Euler scheme. And we did all these implementations. So the Euler scheme using this Black-Scholes model and the Brownian motion. And then we are done. We have created our model, our Monte Carlo simulation. It's now nice to wrap this in a Monte Carlo asset model, because this wrapper here will just create get numerea, get asset value, and so on. Yeah? So now I have here created a model, and I can start evaluating a financial derivative. So before we calculate now the finite difference of the valuation, let's calculate the value of this option here. Now I like to have a call option. So let's maybe try to first calculate the value analytically. So even if I'm interested here in the delta, I calculate first the value using the Black-Scholes model. Black-Scholes option value. So initial value, risk-free rate, volatility, maturity, strike. That should be the analytic value. Because now I can benchmark if everything in my implementation is correct. So let's calculate the value using Monte Carlo. I also create here now get value Monte Carlo, create a small function. So what do I need to create the value using the Monte Carlo? We need our model, we need the maturity, and we need the strike. So let's implement this. So how do we calculate now a European option? So I ask the model for the underlying. So the underlying at maturity. Okay, then the payoff is the underlying minus the strike. And from that, the maximum and zero. So this is floor zero. This is what is paid. And then the value is this discounted by the numerator. So discounted by the numerator means I do payoff divide by the numerator. So numerator at maturity. And I multiply with the numerator at evaluation time. Okay, so let's say this is zero. Yeah? So some hard-coded stuff here. Okay, so, and then return the expectation of this evaluation. Okay, so, and now he complains a little bit that here they throw an exception. So let's, hello. Oh yeah, exceptions are a bit annoying. Okay, so now we have an evaluation here. And let's maybe print this stuff. So since I will print a little bit more results, let's have some function that prints our result. So print result is here some function. So this should be the evaluation. Okay, and what do we have? I always like to print the numerical value and the analytic value. So let's write some function that prints us nicely some results. So this is, I would like to have it a little bit nice. So I use the format function here. So not so widely known. And here you can have some cryptic things that tell you how the columns of this table should look like. So I would like 16 places for this name. Then I would like to have a floating point number, then with nine places and 5 digits after the dot. Then another new column, and I would like to have another such floating point number. So with 9 places and 5 digits after the point. And then I would like to have another floating point number for the error, which has also 9 places, but I would like to have it in scientific notation. Okay, so that is here the name. And let's print this stuff. So first Monte Carlo, analytic, and then maybe also the error, which is Monte Carlo minus analytic. Okay, so sorry for this cryptic stuff here, but keep fingers crossed. If we run this program now, we have maybe a nice output. Yeah, this looks quite nice. Huh? So we have now a Monte Carlo evaluation. Okay. 10,005, is everything correct? Yeah. Okay, so our Monte Carlo algorithm has some Monte Carlo error here, yeah, but apart from that, everything looks quite okay. So next thing is maybe I like to value different financial products. Yeah, so not only here the European option, but also the, say, for example, digital option or something even more smooth. Because later we will need this in our analysis. So maybe I generalize this code a little bit here. And let's define, say, a more general payoff function. So our payoff function is a unary operator, but not a double unary operator. It's a random variable operator, so a random operator. So this is our payoff function. And the payoff function maps the underlying to, for example, for the option, it is underlying minus the strike, floor zero. Yeah, so that is the option payoff function. So payoff function for the option. So then we also have the payoff function for the digital option. So the digital option maps the underlying to underlying minus strike, and then the indicator function. So we choose either one or we choose zero, depending on what's the value of S minus K. Okay, so this scalar is just because it is a random variable. And maybe I would like to have something which is even more smooth than the linear payoff. So let's call also the payoff function of a forward, which is just the identity. Yeah, I mean, it's as smooth as the... Yeah, no, it doesn't have a kink here, no? So it's even smoother. But this here is our linear payoff. This here is our discontinuous payoff. And this here is just in between our classical Black-Scholes European option. So I would like to pass here the payoff function of this option instead of the strike. So here in this get value, I have to change the argument here, and we allow here for a general payoff function. And then I just need to replace this line here. So the payoff is now our general payoff function applied to the underlying. Okay, so let's test if this still works. Yeah, so still works. So you see now I can use this function for many different payoff functions. So we have a model and we have a definition of the financial product. And we have here our valuation, which we just compared. Okay, so next step is let's calculate the delta using finite differences. So we calculate the delta using finite differences. So I would like to have a function here. Let's first calculate the value of the delta using the analytic formula. So there is an analytic formula for the Black-Scholes model for the delta. So the derivative with respect to the initial value. So this is initial value, risk-free rate, volatility, maturity, and strike are needed for this formula. And let's calculate the delta using the Monte Carlo simulation. So get value Monte Carlo. So get value or get delta. Let's call it get delta by finite differences. So let's calculate delta using finite differences. So what do we need? We need the model because we need to create two different models with different initial values. So let's pass the model. And we need the financial product. So we need also the maturity. and the payoff function. So what is paid and when it is paid. So let's do it for the option. And now I need another parameter. Let's have here a shift size. So let's calculate maybe the finite difference approximation here with a shift size. I don't know, take 0.01 or 0.1. And then we print the result. So this is finite difference. So maybe make this a bit nicer here. Huh? Okay. So I need to implement this method. Okay, and this last parameter here is now our shift size. So the nice thing is that we need only to perform two valuations. So we already have a valuation function here. The only thing I need is to create two models with different initial values. So actually now I could call this get model function here with two different initial values. Yeah? So for that, actually initial value should be an argument here, but maybe take a little shortcut. There is a method that you can call on a model which gives you a copy of the model with a different parameter. So it's called get clone with modified data, and the parameter you like to modify it has to be provided as a map. So, and the parameter we like to modify is the initial value. So, and we like to have the model with the initial value plus shift. Okay, so this is our new model. So it's also a Monte Carlo model. The model upshift. Okay, so from that we can calculate the value under this upshifted model. So this is just, I call our get value method with the upshifted model maturity and our payoff function. So maybe this parameter here should not be called payoff function option. It's just a general payoff function. And you see, I can now perform finite differences for general payoff functions and general models. So let's have another model with a downshift and calculate the value under the downshifted model. Okay, and return the finite difference. So this is value upshift minus downshift divided by 2 times shift size. Okay, and here he is complaining that he likes to have some exception handling. So let's be a little bit brutal here, because in this experiment we don't care about a nice exception handling. So in case there is an exception, I just return not a number. No? If everything runs well, there should be no problem with this finite difference. So let's try the program and see if we can calculate a finite difference. No, I did something wrong. Ah, okay. Because here it's still value Monte Carlo. So this should be now the delta analytic and the Monte Carlo finite difference delta. Okay, so maybe I call this here delta value delta finite difference. Did I do something wrong? Because the result looks so bad. Oh, yes, I see. Here it's Black-Scholes digital option delta. Actually, I would like to have the Black-Scholes option delta. So let's see. This analytic value here was wrong. So let's see. Yep, now it looks good. Okay, so we get with the finite difference an approximation of the delta, which is more or less like the analytic solution. Error is here 10 to the minus 3. Okay, so I would like to continue this in the next session, but maybe give me 2 or 3 more minutes, because now I would like to investigate what does the shift size do to this finite difference approximation. Okay, so maybe I do it just here with the printout, and next time we do some plots. Yeah? So you see, I can take very small shifts. If you do large shifts, say something like 10, still works. Yeah? If we take small shifts, okay, we get nothing, yeah, which is what we know due to the computer arithmetic, 10 to the minus 14. Very big error. Okay, completely nonsense. Okay, but this is a fairly small shift, already quite good. Yeah, I've seen better ones, but already quite good. So in the next session, I would like to continue this investigation. So we will continue this program. We will also create plots and investigate certain regions. And of course, we will also investigate the other financial products. And then we learn alternative methods, alternatives to finite difference. Unfortunately, time is up now.